Thank you. The final item of business is the Member's Business Debate on Motion 7769 in the name of Evelyn Tweed on National Lyme Disease Awareness Month. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Evelyn Tweed to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Ms Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am very happy to speak in the Chamber in Lyme Disease Awareness Month. This is a very personal debate for me, as I first became aware of Lyme disease through my good friend Pauline Bowie, who I have known since our university days. Pauline is now an ambassador for the Lyme Resource Centre, and she is in the gallery tonight with fellow Lyme disease sufferers, colleagues and young people from St Peter the Apostle High School in Clydebank, and I warmly welcome them to our Scottish Parliament. Working at a summer camp in 1989, she noticed a small circular rash on her thigh, and Pauline was told by the director that it was probably ringworm. Over the next few years, she suffered a whole range of debilitating symptoms, from those associated with the flu to inflamed joints, nausea, insomnia and dizziness. She had breathing difficulties, heart palpitations, and was diagnosed with anxiety and hyperventilation, and told how to use a paper bag to breathe into. She was unable to do many of the things that she loved, but could not get answers from doctors. Years passed and her symptoms worsened. By the mid-2000s, she had extreme joint pain. In 2017, she suffered two instances of pain so extreme that she was hospitalised with suspected heart attacks. Dizziness, speech slurring, blurred vision and brain fog were all put down to anxiety. Tests were inconclusive. 30 years later, after hearing her cousin was ill with Lyme disease, she Googled it. And she was very shocked to find out that she was a textbook case. Lyme disease is caused by a bacteria called Lyme borreliosis, which can be passed on to humans by infected ticks. Ticks infected with Lyme disease are found all over the UK. Anywhere there are pets, wild mammals, birds, there are ticks. Woodland, open countryside, and even urban parks and gardens. Removing ticks quickly will help prevent infection, but removing them incorrectly may actually increase the infection risk. Many people with early symptoms develop a circular red skin rash around the tick bite, often described as looking like a bullseye on a dartboard. Lyme disease can also cause flu-like symptoms, fever, fatigue, and migratory joint or muscle aches and pains. There are conflicting opinions on how best to treat Lyme disease, but it is most often treated through a course or courses of antibiotics. Lyme disease can often be treated effectively if detected early on, but if it's not treated early or treatment is delayed, there's a risk of developing very severe and long-lasting symptoms like Pauline's. For people without the red rash, laboratory tests are used to diagnose Lyme. However, the tests are not sensitive and can't tell the difference between current or past infections. There are enormous challenges here in diagnosing Lyme disease. Many don't notice they've been bitten by a tick. This is easily done when some bites are as small as a poppy seed. When their symptoms appear, they don't associate it with ticks. This happened to Leslie Patterson, world champion triathlete and Oscar-winning screenwriter from my constituency. Lyme disease took her out for a year. Even now, it still impacts her. And like many others, she has no idea where or when she was infected. What we see is the classic indicator of Lyme, the bullseye rash, often doesn't look like a bullseye. It can appear in different shapes as well as different presentations on darker skins. And it doesn't appear at all in around a third of the cases. Its wide-ranging symptoms can look like any number of other conditions, leading Lyme disease to be called the Great Pretender. Symptoms which later turn out to be caused by Lyme disease are misdiagnosed as other conditions, such as anxiety or chronic fatigue. Patients have been dismissed and told the symptoms are in their heads. When Pauline told her doctor she thought she might have Lyme, she was told that she was jumping on a fad. Inevitably, this lack of awareness amongst GPs has a detrimental effect along existing lines of inequality. Those already marginalised, women, disabled people, people of colour, are less likely to get a diagnosis and timely treatment. Lyme Disease Action developed an online training course in collaboration with the Royal College of General Practitioners, covering how to identify and treat the disease. However, the charity Lyme Disease UK notes that only a very small percentage of GPs have actually taken the course. Tick bites are often associated with recreational activities like hill walking or working in sectors such as forestry, farming. However, more evidence is being found of tick bites being much closer to home. The Big Tick Project found that one third of dogs checked in their study had ticks attached to them. Pet owners are at risk as ticks can drop off in the home or transfer. But 47% of owners were not aware that they too were at risk of infection from tick-borne diseases. The British Medical Journal has called for more national and international debates on Lyme disease, which I'm glad that we are contributing to today. They have also called for a solid research agenda, as well as robust public awareness campaigns. Indeed, Dr. Lucy Gilbert, a senior research fellow from Glasgow University, has noted the need for more research into tick populations and Lyme disease in urban areas. However, funding remains a challenge. There is huge appetite to make change in this area from committed and well-informed organisations such as the Lyme Resource Centre, leading awareness campaigns to startups in the Highlands who are developing an app to map the risk of Lyme disease. As well as awareness raising, action such as bracken control can also help to mitigate risks. The issues here are multi-sectoral, overlapping healthcare, education, forestry and land management to academia. To take successful action... Yes, I'll...
Rachel Hamilton.
Evelyn Tweed for taking the intervention, Presiding Officer. From what she's saying, deer are a key host of ticks, so it's important that we support our rural workforce to ensure that we have individuals who are able to effectively manage those deer population to stop the spread of Lyme's disease.
Evelyn Tweed.
I would say, thank you for the intervention, Rachel Hamilton. I would say anything that we can do to look at the tick population and Lyme disease needs to be considered, in my opinion. So, where was I? Right, I'm going to go back to the part that I was just finishing off there. The issues here are multi-sectoral, overlapping healthcare, education, forestry, farming and land management to academia. To take successful action, a collaborative approach is required. I look forward to hearing everyone's contribution today in the Chamber to the debate and hearing what steps the Scottish Government will take to engage stakeholders and tackle the issues surrounding this complex disease. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Tweed. And I now call on Marie McNair to be followed by Alexander Burnett. Ms. McNair, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by congratulating my colleague Evelyn Tweed for securing this important debate and her thoughtful and knowledgeable opening speech. I'm pleased to be able to speak in tonight's debate, raising awareness of Lyme disease. It can be devastating to people, and it is vital everyone knows how to prevent its transmission. I'm a committed campaigner on this issue, and this debate is very welcome. It's been a useful vehicle to help get the message out. In Scotland, there has been a significant increase in the number of cases of Lyme disease being reported each year. Lyme disease is an increasing problem. As we enter the warmer summer months, it is vital that alongside our healthcare partners, we do all we can to ensure our constituents are properly informed about its dangers. One of the few benefits that came out of the COVID-19 pandemic was that many took the time to explore everything Scotland has to offer, spending time walking, hiking and enjoying our beautiful outdoor spaces. We're so fortunate to have such fantastic countryside on our doorstep, but with this renewed desire to explore these areas, there has been also a sharp rise in the number of people being bitten by ticks, the main driver of Lyme disease in Scotland. Recent research found that almost two-thirds of people in Scotland have either been bitten by or know someone who has been bitten by a tick. More concerning than this, however, is that the same research found that over half of people in Scotland don't know what to do when bitten by a tick. These are extremely concerning figures and show just how much work we still need to do. I'm also pleased to repeat the experience of my constituent Pauline, who joined us here today in the public gallery alongside pupils from St Peter the Apostle High School in Clydebank. Pauline is keen to raise awareness of its impact and share her story. And as Pauline's MSP, I'm happy to do so and ensure the voices of my constituents are heard in our Parliament. After being bitten by a tick over 30 years ago, Pauline experienced flu-like symptoms and expanding bullseye rash. Pauline was misdiagnosed numerous times, and after seeing a range of different specialists, it wasn't until 2018 that she was finally diagnosed with Lyme disease. Unfortunately, she spent decades of facing a wide range of debilitating symptoms before getting the treatment she needed. This was an absolutely horrific experience for Pauline, and we must do everything we can so that situations like this don't happen again. I was also struck by the case of Rico Frankie, publicised by the NHS. Rico is a 40-year-old father of three who has lived with Lyme disease for over 12 years. He went from being a super fit gym goer to being completely floored. His lifestyle was significantly disrupted. And if it can happen to Rico, it can happen to any one of us. There is no cure for Lyme disease, so we must do three things. We must educate people about prevention, improve our testing capacities, ensure patients with Lyme disease get the support and treatment they need. With the warmer summer months just around the corner, it is important we prioritise the first of these actions, educating people about dealing with tick bites. Always check for ticks after spending time in green spaces. Carefully remove any as soon as possible. Even actually make sure your socks are tucked into your trousers. And also, if you have a red circular rash and flu-like symptoms, arrange to see your GP urgently. We want to see people enjoy their time in Scotland's beautiful outdoors, but we also want to make sure they're doing so safely so that they don't have to go through what Pauline and Rico and many others have had to endure. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. I now call on Alexander Burnett to be followed by Jim Fairley. Mr Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking Evelyn Tweed for securing this very important debate, recognising National Lyme Disease Awareness Month. And since elected in 2016, I've been involved with a campaign to improve awareness, diagnosis and treatment, meeting with petitioners, professors, doctors and groups such as Tick-Borne Illness Campaign Scotland to try and make progress on improving materials and education on the disease. Sadly, as we've heard, many sufferers of Lyme disease are misdiagnosed due to the lack of knowledge surrounding the disease, which can have long-lasting and debilitating effects. Now, whilst we try and encourage people to enjoy the outdoors and explore our beautiful countryside, thousands of new cases are detected every year in the UK. And so we need to educate medical staff to ensure they recognise the disease, because we know that with Lyme disease, early diagnosis and treatment is vital. Otherwise, patients risk devastating symptoms. Early signs, as we've heard, can include the bullseye rash, flu-like symptoms and fatigue. But untreated, this can develop into joint pain and swelling, nerve problems, heart problems and chronic fatigue syndrome. And it's very troubling to hear of a new TBE virus in the UK, which reportedly can be fatal. and I hope the Scottish Government engage with a UK-wide approach to improve detection of this. But this is not just a rural issue, as budget cuts to councils have seen less grass cutting in urban parks, often dressed up as conservation, but actually just creating a breeding ground for ticks and more infections. And whilst advice such as rolling up our socks might seem sound, it is akin to the former First Minister telling schools to chop the bottom off doors during the pandemic. It is a poor substitute for improving resources and public awareness campaigns from the Scottish Government. We need to ensure that all avenues of raising awareness are used. So I was very interested in the Lyme app being piloted in the Highlands a few years ago, but I've heard no more progress on this and when it will be extended across Scotland, and hopefully the Minister can update us on this project tonight. I'm also delighted that the first ever conference on tick-borne diseases will be held in Inverness later this month. Now, over the last few months, I've raised numerous questions in Parliament to find out what action is happening. And the Scottish Government recently confirmed it will continue using their own platforms to highlight the risk and symptoms of Lyme disease. Yet 3 years ago, when I asked how much traffic their webpages obtained, the results were poor. Their Avoiding Bugs and Germs Outdoors page, which also contains information relating to Lyme disease, had little over 12,000 views in the last 3 years, till 2020. So I'd be interested to hear the updated figures for this and other sites. But in a world with social media at our fingertips, the Scottish Government Health page and the Office of the Chief Executive of NHS Scotland haven't tweeted about Lyme disease since last year. And the NHS National Services Scotland account hasn't tweeted about ticks or Lyme disease since 2020. And along with Public Health Scotland and Nature Scot, not one account has tweeted in support of Lyme Disease Awareness Month. So can the Minister tell me, where are these public campaigns that the SNP Government promises?
Certainly. Jim Fairley.
I'd like to thank the Member for taking an intervention. I'm really not sure if he just hadn't seen it, but I noticed a Scottish Government awareness campaign about ticks yesterday.
Alexander Burnett.
I'm very glad for the member. I don't think that reduces the point that there are numerous sites within the Scottish Government's control which should be pushing the awareness of Lyme disease and are clearly failing to do so. So the question is still to the Minister, where is the information being spread to as many people as possible to warn them of the risks of ticks? And what commitments will the Scottish Government make to improving awareness, testing and treatment of Lyme disease? And finally, who exactly is and sits on the Scottish Government-led Lyme Disease Awareness Raising Group, and what action have they taken this month? Because after 7 years of being involved in this subject, the silence is deafening. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Burnett. I now call Jim Fairley to be followed by Carol Mochan. Mr. Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Now, I'd like to thank my colleague Evelyn Tweed for bringing forward this absolutely vital debate on May being Lyme Disease Awareness Month. My contribution this evening will be based around cause and effect. Lyme disease is spread by ticks, so the effect of not controlling tick in their habitat is more Lyme's disease. Now, I used to marvel at the skill and stockmanship of folk I used to refer to as the High Hill folk, farming cattle and sheep on the hills over thousands of acres with wild-bred sheep and dogs to match. Now, ticks were a huge concern, which is why the old sheep dip pens would be a hive of activity at least twice a year as neighbours rallied round to help each other get the hill yows dipped. The spring rise before dipping could literally see hundreds of ticks hanging from pregnant sheep, causing anemia, poor thrive, or the killing diseases Lyme virus or tick-borne fever in young stock. In areas of high infection, Lyme could kill anywhere between 5 and 10% of young stock in any given year. And the need for hill-bred sheep to be bound to the ground is in large part due to the ability of the sheep to be able to deal with tick-borne infections through genetics of generations of sheep being on the same ground over many decades. If new sheep were brought onto that ground, losses due to tick-borne fever or Lyme could be as high as 60% of infective animals. It's for those reasons that chemical preventions were created with the old-fashioned and now no longer used organophosphate dips. They were highly effective at killing ticks and scab mite on sheep, and I can remember quite vividly the clean smell as well as the lift in health and condition and the vitality of freshly dipped sheep. Now, those dips were, however, not without side effects, particularly for humans, and were then replaced with the synthetic pyrethroid dips. They were good at controlling scab in sheep, but not ticks. So that meant the invention and evolution of the now used poron insecticides, which are extremely effective at killing huge numbers of ticks, which in turn makes it easier for humans and dogs to avoid being bitten. Presiding Officer, the reason for me asking for this indulgence in describing hill farming and its history of association and controlling tick infections is that over the last 20 to 30 years, literally hundreds of thousands of sheep have been taken off the hills as farmers have found it harder and harder to be profitable. What that has meant is that the tick has been allowed to thrive unchecked over huge swathes of Scotland where the sheep have gone off. Grousemoor managers were for a number of years buying hundreds of male castrate sheep called wethers and running them over the hills as tick mops to try and control the tick numbers. These wether sheep would be treated with chemical poron, released to the hill, and as they swept over the ground, they would be mopping up huge numbers of tick, which would in turn be killed with insecticide that was on the sheep.
Finlay Carson.
I thank the member for taking the intervention. I absolutely agree with the measures that are taken to reduce the load of ticks that are in the environment and therefore reduce the impact on humans. But would the member agree with me that bracken control is absolutely vital in reducing the tick load in the countryside? And right now, there's only one chemical that can actually do that effectively, and that's Azulux. We're waiting for an emergency authorisation to use that, and Nature Scotland have called for that emergency authorisation to come into force. So would the member agree with me that we need a year-on-year licence to allow this chemical to be used, rather than the annual circus where we see farmers and sprayers having to argue their point on an annual basis?
Jim Fairley.
Patience is a virtue, is all I'll say to Mr Carson. That was coming in my speech. This man-made intervention of treating sheep for ticks has helped ground nesting birds, wildlife, grousemoor managers and sheep and cattle farmers, and as a byproduct of that, helps folk that we tell to go out and enjoy the countryside, the ramblers, the walkers, the hikers, the campers, who take to the hills in their thousands every weekend, by cutting down the sheer weight of tick numbers that can infect people, mammals and birds alike. And this is just one part of the interventions we can use, amongst others, as habitat control. And that brings me on to the subject that is high on the agenda right now, which is bracken control. Bracken, as we know, is a noxious weed that grows in abundance in our hills, reaching up to 5 or 6 feet tall and blanketing literally thousands of acres of hill ground and ensuring that nothing else can grow. It creates virtual bracken deserts, but as importantly, it is a harbinger for huge numbers of ticks. And with its height, it means that ticks can be shoulder or even head height to a human as it waits for a host to feed on. Now, my colleague Fergus Ewan will talk more in depth about this, but bracken control is difficult, especially on hill ground, which is often very steep and dangerous for mechanical interventions. So in concluding, Presiding Officer, my ask of the Scottish Government is that I would urge with maximum urgency the licences needed for aerial bracken control using Azulam are issued. For the avoidance of doubt, no one uses Azulox unless at an absolute last resort, not least of all because of the cost. And there has been no new science this year that would have been different from last year. I very much hope the decision to issue the licences will be imminent. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Fairley. And I now call Cara Mochan to be followed by Liam MacArthur. Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Evelyn Tweed for bringing this really interesting debate to the Chamber. I say that, included in tonight's debate because I don't put myself forward as an expert at all, so I have really tried to listen hard to the contributions made by all the members, and I will endeavour to go back and speak to the Labour group about this, because it does seem that it is a really important issue that we need to push and get right for people. But I am grateful for the opportunity to speak in the debate on behalf of Scottish Labour and do make that commitment, as I've said. Like many in the Chamber, I represent a rural region, south of Scotland, which has so much beautiful woodland and outdoor space. And so, even before the debate, I did recognise the importance of raising this, recognising the issues of ticks and the associated bacterial infection of Lyme disease. We know that symptoms may not be easily recognised and diagnosed and can be missed, as Evelyn Tweed mentions. So I do hope highlighting the issue will help us ensure better awareness within the population, so reducing infection risks and supporting NHS staff and the healthcare workforce in recognising the signs and symptoms resulting in appropriate diagnosis of this condition. As we have heard, Lyme disease is a bacterial infection spread to humans by infected ticks. Any of us who have dogs that enjoy long woodland walks recognise ticks as tiny spider-like creatures found in woodland and heath areas. Ticks can be found in any areas with deep or overgrown vegetation where you have access to animals to feed on. Although reported to be more prevalent in the Highlands of Scotland, it is not just rural areas, as we've heard. Woodlands and dense vegetation in urban parks see plenty of wildlife, including the spider-like tick. And members have really brought that to the Chamber very well, the fact that we are now seeing it in other areas, in areas where more humans would be walking. Ticks, as we've heard, feed in the blood of birds and mammals, including humans, and that, of course, is where the problem lies. Ticks bite and could potentially infect us with Lyme disease. A tick bite can only cause Lyme disease in humans if the tick has already bitten an infected animal. And so in some of the research I was looking at, it was talking about just, I think, what some of the other members were speaking about, the different way in which farmers manage their animals nowadays. Members have raised the important information needed to recognise tick bite signs and symptoms, and of course when to seek medical advice. But also, I didn't have this in my speech, but also I think it is really relevant, some of the other matters that I hadn't gone over in researching this around the management of the farmlands and beautiful countryside around us, so I appreciate that. But there was a couple of things that struck me that were of interest to raise with the public and raise with the Minister. And firstly, that was ticks will bite and feed on your dog and cat, and that's really relevant in sort of urban areas. And they can be on your dog or your cat for a few days and then drop off. And it is possible the tick could pass disease onto your pet, and that includes Lyme disease. Now, during my research for the debate, I did notice information about signs and symptoms on dogs and cats as well. And I believe that the pet-loving Scottish public would wish to know some of this, that their animals can get it. But it is also very relevant, as Evelyn Tweed mentioned, in preventing tick transfer to humans. The second point I wish to raise was about workplace safety, which Rachel Hamilton raised, and the Scottish Woodland Trust have the Lyme Disease UK as their charity this year for that very reason, because they're very aware that their staff working in this field could be affected by Lyme disease, and they're very, very keen to see further research into Lyme disease, which I think is important. Just in the interest of time, I will move on and say my speech had talked about some of the things that other members have talked about sensible things that you can do, but I think it's really important that the Minister does feedback to us on the fact that we need to raise that public awareness about some of the really reasonable and easy things that you can do, but just how we manage this in the countryside as well. So thank you very much, Presiding Officers, and to all the members that spoke tonight.
Thank you, Ms Mochan. And I now call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Fergus Ewing. Mr MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's been a few years since I've had the opportunity to take part in a debate on Lyme disease, which is an important but I think often under-recognised issue. So I warmly congratulate Evelyn Tweed and thank her for providing this opportunity, and also extend my welcome to those in the gallery who's joining us this evening. A thanks too to those who've provided briefings for this evening's debate. I think I first came into contact with the issue of Lyme's disease when I was a member of the then Rural Affairs Committee back in the 2007-11 session of Parliament. And I think we have come a bit of a distance since then. I don't think it's fair to say there's been no progress. I noticed that the Scottish Land and Estates briefing does acknowledge that medical awareness of Lyme's disease is better than it was. Is it as good as it needs to be? Possibly not. I think there's variability, but certainly there seems to be a bit of progress that's been made in that sense. But nevertheless, I think as Evelyn Tweed and others have identified, we are looking at an increased incidence of tick-borne Lyme disease as a result of many different factors. I think we've heard in terms of the changing in farming practices that Jim Fairley was referring to. I think the extension of afforestation now and going forward is likely to play a part as well. But I think some of the issues we're seeing around climate change are also having effect in terms of increasing the number of ticks and therefore heightening the risk of infection. We're also seeing, I think, higher numbers being diagnosed, but still, I think it's accepted an underreporting and certainly continued missed or underdiagnosing as well. And I think all of that speaks to the need to redouble efforts to raise that awareness, improve the diagnosis and the treatments that are available. I think Evelyn Tweed was right to point that there isn't a magic bullet in this respect, but early diagnosis and early treatment certainly improves the outcomes. There are clearly those who are most more at risk in terms of our farmers, our foresters, land managers, and those accessing the countryside as well, our hikers, ramblers, etc. But the point being made by Evelyn Tweed and Carol Mockin and others about the risks to those who don't necessarily fall into that category, to dog owners, for example, and I say this as the owner of a Springer Spaniel who spends far too much time sticking his head where it shouldn't be and is picking up ticks on a regular basis that we need to deal with. I think raising awareness amongst groups that perhaps didn't really see this as an issue for them will be a focus of attention going forward. And I think Jim Fairley was also right to point to, yes, there's a human risk here, but the risk in terms of livestock, particularly for lyping ill, shouldn't be underestimated either. So I think I would join with others in underscoring the need for increased research, for bracking control, which there's not a silver bullet, but there is no doubt that I think a more sensible approach to the licensing of Azulam would certainly help and make a huge difference, and continued efforts in the area of awareness raising. And I would say that will need to be done carefully, because I think what we don't want to do is spread fear and alarm, discourage the public from accessing the countryside in a responsible fashion. We don't want to be necessarily overloading laboratories with testing that isn't necessarily of a benefit, but I think we need to acknowledge there is a risk, a heightened risk going forward that needs to be addressed, and that awareness raising campaign, as Alexander Burnett was pointing out, will I think need to ramp up, it will need to extend, it will need to become a bit more sophisticated in a social media age to communicate the very important message that Evelyn Tweed's has allowed this Parliament to reinforce this evening. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Mr. MacArthur. And I now call Fergus Ewing, who will be the last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond. Mr. Ewing.
Presiding Officer, I warmly congratulate Evelyn Tweed on bringing this debate here and for her very moving account of the horrific impacts that this disease has had on her constituents who are here this evening. So because of that, it's vital that we take all steps to prevent others from being in the position of being exposed to infection, likely infection, of this disease. Bracken habitat, as members have said, is by far the most important habitat or reservoir habitat for ticks and tick-borne disease. And Professor Roy Brown, an expert on bracken and ticks, a lifelong expert, has highlighted that there's far more bracken. It's grown exponentially, and there's far more ticks in the bracken, and a far higher proportion of the ticks, particularly adult females, I understand, are infective and carry various diseases, of which Lyme's disease is perhaps the best known, but lyping ill, as Liam MacArthur has mentioned, is also there, and related to other forms of ill health. Now, the only way to tackle this at the moment effectively is the Azulam Azulox, and Scottish Land and Estates confirm that in their representations to us all tonight. And Azulox is unfortunately subject to a process of annual emergency authorisation. I mean, it should be used automatically, frankly. The science is the same as it was last year, but this process, this laborious process, has to be undergone. The four administrations in the UK must issue approvals to the Health and Safety Executive, who have delegated responsibility to give advice to the four administrations. And that as a process is fine, but it's too slow. I've been in correspondence with HSE last year and again this year, and just before this debate was informed that they have not yet taken a decision. Now, nobody really wants to get into the blame game, but it is apparent for whatever reason the delay has occurred, it's now very serious, and particularly so because, as it happens, the manufacturer of the drug has now been shifted to India, and therefore there could be a further delay of 6 weeks before it can be procured, and it needs to be applied, Presiding Officer, in a season which finishes in August, September. The window is very short indeed. We are on the last week before authorisation can be given and can be ineffective. And that's why we really do need to get a substantive response from the HSE. And I would particularly be grateful to the Minister. I know she is very knowledgeable about Azulox. Before her elevation, she was working alongside Mr. Fairley, myself and others to advance the arguments I'm making this evening. And I know from last week's response, when I raised this issue with the First Minister and FMQ, that he says it's a serious threat that needs to be dealt with. And he did say in that response to me, Presiding Officer, that the HSE had made a recommendation and that the Scottish Government had considered and responded to that recommendation. But he didn't say what that response was. So, being an inquisitive kind of guy, as members may know, can the Minister share with us, because I think we're all coming from the same angle here, we want to get this sorted. What was that response? I know, I believe it's Minister Slater that's responsible. Did she say yes or not? What was the response? Because we do need to be clear that Scotland has played our part in getting this to a yes. Now, there's some suggestion from the UK government that a further treatment known as amidosulfuron, or Squire Ultra, its commercial name, is being considered. This is not effective. And let me make that point clear. Clear advice is that won't work. So if the UK government is considering that, it should think again. Sorry, officer, in conclusion, Liam MacArthur is right. We don't want to set hares running. We don't want to set alarm for people who want to enjoy the countryside. But on the other hand, we owe it to our population to take all practical and sensible steps to avoid further people getting this ghastly disease, people that work in rural Scotland, as has been highlighted by members across the chamber. And it would be catastrophic if a process of approval, a cumbersome, unnecessarily complicated process, were to become the enemy of achieving the purpose of that very process, which is designed to protect the public against the risk of contracting a disease, which, as Evelyn Tweed has said, is an extremely serious one, albeit that it's not sufficiently well understood or appreciated in society as a whole.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. And I now call on the Minister, Jenny Minto, to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too like to join other members here today in thanking Evelyn Tweed for bringing this motion to the Chamber during Lyme Disease Awareness Month. And also I'd like to welcome Pauline and everyone else to the gallery, and I hope your recovery continues. I'm very pleased to have the opportunity to close this debate and to highlight the importance of raising awareness of Lyme disease. We know that the majority of cases Lyme disease can be treated with antibiotics, but for some it can have serious impact on their daily lives. I've literally 30 seconds in, Douglas Lumsden, I'm sorry. My first encounter with a tick was almost 50 years ago. I spotted this odd growth on my spaniel's head. Thankfully, a friend knew what it was and quickly whipped it out with tweezers. At that point, it was just an ugly beastie. But now I know so much more about the impact ticks can have on our health and the importance of removing them safely. And I really appreciate the contributions that have been made by various members in this debate. So now, every walk I go on, I check my colleague Jim for ticks, as well as ensuring I'm tick-free too. I'd like to touch on some of the contributions from members to this debate, but first of all, I'll take Mr. Lumsden's intervention.
Dr. Lumsden.
I'd like to thank the Minister for taking the intervention. I've been contacted by a constituent, Emily Gilmore from Inverurie, who has Lyme disease along with her son as well, but has spent £40,000 so far on private treatment abroad. So will the Minister look into this case and see if she can get the treatment she requires here in Scotland?
Minister.
Thank you. I thank Douglas Lumsden for that intervention. And as I can't comment specifically on cases, but yes, I would be happy to look further into that. It is these personal stories that Evelyn Tweed and Marie McNair both
spoke about that are so important, that really emphasise the need for increasing awareness and a coordinated approach. And Marie McNair talked about educating, testing and supporting the right treatment. Alexander Burnett commented on the awareness campaign. And I've just had a wee look. The government, Scottish Government tweeted 5 days ago about Lyme's disease. And we've also put things on Facebook and Instagram, and we'll have a wider campaign.
Alexander Burnett.
Thank the Minister for taking that intervention. Jim Fairley also mentioned that the Scottish Government had tweeted about that, and I sadly accept that. However, none of the health sites, you might have been mistaken, I referred to the Scottish Government health sites, none of them have tweeted or posted around any of that. And as that is under the Minister's portfolio, I wonder if she could comment on that.
Minister.
Thank Alexander Burnett for that, and I think this debate is really important, and so therefore there will be tweets going out as a result of this debate from Public Health Scotland account, the Minister of Public Health and Women's Health account, and also I will be retweeting, so I hope Alexander Burnett will join me in retweeting as well, and thank him for his intervention. The points that Jim Fairley raised with regard to sheep being tick magnets, I too have heard from a number of my constituents. And Carol Mochan, I think you've just, in your speech, really emphasised the importance of having debates like this in the Chamber and recognising as well that they're prevalent in urban areas as well as in workforces and on our pets, which I've noted as well. So I thank you for recognising that, and I look forward to hearing how you speak about it further within your group as well. And I really appreciated Liam MacArthur's acknowledgement about careful education and acknowledging the importance of awareness in the population, and also about proportional control. And I agree that we should not be alarmist. If I may at this point, I know that a number of members have brought in, have discussed Azulux, and as Fergus Ewing pointed out, it doesn't fall within my portfolio. However, I would like to comment that the Scottish Government does absolutely recognise concerns about the potential risk of uncontrolled bracken and is aware of the role that bracken plays in relation to tick populations, and the role that Azulux has played in recent years. As the member pointed out, Azulux has no current UK or EU authorisation, and the HSE is responsible for assessing emergency authorisations. The Scottish Government has responded, as the First Minister said, to the HSE's recommendation, as will all UK administrations. And it's the HSE who will respond to the applicant when ready to do so. And I'm afraid at this point I can't provide any further update to this. I've taken a few, Mr Carson, so I think I'll just continue. Thank you. But I note the points that Mr Ewing and others have made. As we've heard in this debate, this debate coincides with Lyme Disease Awareness Month, but it is also important, as we've seen a rise in cases in Scotland in recent years, as Marie McNair noted. We are blessed in Scotland that we have such amazing opportunities to get out and explore our wonderful country, whether climbing mountains, walking in woodland, or simply enjoying a stroll in the park. And although we believe there's no such thing as bad weather, just bad clothing, it is true that spring and summer, more people are likely to be enjoying the out of doors. Therefore, providing information on how to avoid being bitten by a tick, how to remove an attached tick safely, and the signs and symptoms to be aware of is absolutely key. We know that prevention is the best defence against Lyme disease, and the Scottish Government is committed to raising awareness of Lyme disease and are currently running a campaign, Find a Tick, Remove It Quick, with posters and information cards in every community pharmacy in Scotland. We want to highlight the key messages of tick avoidance, signs and symptoms to watch out for, and signposting to NHS Inform for further information. I would like to thank the Lyme Disease Awareness Raising Group, whose membership includes representatives from the Lyme Resource Centre, Visit Scotland, Ramblers Scotland and Public Health Scotland, as well as the Scottish Government officials from Infectious Diseases, Early Learning and Childcare and Active Scotland, who co-designed this campaign. We are also planning a follow-up in the summer with posters in GP practices, leisure centres, libraries and community centres, and hopefully public transport as well. And this will reinforce key messages for people who have already seen the campaign, but also target people who are visiting Scotland from the rest of the UK or abroad. I also appreciate that work needs to be done to raise awareness of Lyme's disease amongst health professionals to ensure confidence in diagnosing the condition and starting patients on antibiotic treatment as soon as possible. If early signs are missed, it is more likely that longer-term symptoms will develop, and I absolutely recognise the importance of this, with a member of my own family spotting the symptoms and, thankfully, a very aware GP. We are making progress in Scotland on testing and diagnosis, and we're also working closely with stakeholders and clinicians through Health Professionals Education Subgroup. Following the recent identification in Scotland of a probable case of tick-borne encephalitis, which is potentially a serious infection, clinical surveillance has been increased. Public Health Scotland have requested the UK Health Security Agency undertake tick capture and testing in Lough Erne-head in mid to late June to assess whether TBE infection can be identified in ticks in Scotland. It's important to note, however, that one probable case is not evidence of a significant change to the human health risk in Scotland from TBE. But, in my view, rightly, the Scottish Health Protection Network Tick-Borne Diseases Group, a multidisciplinary expert group dedicated to Lyme disease, has recently reconvened following the COVID-19 pandemic, and officials have requested that surveillance, including for TBE, be included as part of their future work. So, in closing, Presiding Officer, I would reiterate that the risk of Lyme disease should not put people off spending time outdoors. There are a few simple steps that you can take to protect yourself. Cover up bare skin. Ideally, wear long trousers and tuck them into your socks, if in long grass, which has been said. Use insect repellent. Check yourself and clothing for ticks after being outside. If you find one, carefully remove the whole tick using a tick remover or fine tweezers, and speak to your GP if you develop symptoms. I would like to reiterate my thanks to Evelyn Tweed for bringing this motion today, and to everyone here who has contributed to this debate to raise awareness of Lyme disease.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.